Okay, I should probably start. Okay, last a couple of lectures, two or three lectures ago, I looked briefly at the systems which were originally thought suitable for implementing Majorana fermions and hopefully for implementing topological quantum computing. And these are basically two-dimensional P plus IP Fermi superfluids, of which the principal examples that we think we know are, first of all, with some confidence, I think we can say, the A phase of superfluid helium-3. I think there really is rather strong experimental evidence that that is a P plus IP Fermi superfluid. It's most certainly a P-wave superfluid. The evidence for the explicit evidence for breaking of time reversal invariance is perhaps not so strong until quite recently, but everyone's pretty confident that it is a P plus IP Fermi superfluid. So that's one case we know for sure. The other case, a second case which is thought with high probability to be a P plus IP Fermi superfluid is strontium ruthenate, the metal strontium ruthenate. And then, of course, in the future at least, there may be ultra-cold alkali gases which can realise that state. But from a practical point of view, none of these is really that good. first of all, no one, you remember, if we have a two-component, that is, up, up and down, down, if we have a two-component, P plus IP Fermi superfluid, then in order to create single Majorana fermions and therefore to be able to carry out topological quantum computation, you need to produce half quantum vortices. Ordinary vortices won't do because they carry a Majorana fermion for each spin and that complicates matters. So you need to produce half quantum vortices, and at least to date, there have been really been no evidence for half quantum vortices in helium-3a, despite the fact that people have looked in the region where you would expect to find them. So that certainly seems a problem. The strontium ruthenate, well, as we saw, two or three years ago, my colleague Rafi Badakian, who's actually here, of course, did do some magnetotorque experiments, which produced fairly convincing evidence for half quantum vortices in strontium ruthenate. But he was only getting one at a time. As far as I know, no one has ever seen more than one half quantum vortex in strontium ruthenate. So, again, that doesn't make a terribly promising practical candidate for topological quantum computation. So people started a few years ago, people started to look for more practical systems, and the history of this is slightly convoluted. Originally, the original proposal was to take a semiconductor with strong spin-orbit coupling and put on top of that an ordinary S-wave superconductor with a vortex in it. Eventually, though, people realised that the vortex wasn't actually necessary, one could do without it. And so a solution which is was proposed by these two groups about 6 years ago and has become actually of very great interest is to take a semiconducting wire with a strong spin-orbit interaction and also with a magnetic field on it and couple it to an ordinary S-wave superconductor in such a way that at least one of the parameters involved, that is the spin-orbit coupling, the magnetic field, the chemical potential or the gap, they have a lot of things to play around with, at least one of these is varying in space in an interesting way. We'll see what interesting means in a few minutes. And the proposal which was originally made, the semiconductor which was originally proposed was indium arsenide. In fact, in real life, people tend to use indium antimonide for technical reasons which I'm not entirely familiar with. And then they couple that to an ordinary S-wave superconductor, which might, for example, have been niobium, in some kind of interesting geometry. Here are two rather straightforward examples of that. This group proposed that you would have actually a sort of squid ring, an almost squid ring, made of niobium superconductor, and you would bridge the gap with an indium arsenide wire. And in that case, what is varying in space is obviously the superconducting gap, because it's non-zero here, but zero in the gap itself. The an alternative proposal was, again, to take indium arsenide, now in full contact everywhere with niobium, but in this case, what they're going to do is to vary the chemical potential by putting gates on at various points on the wire. This is actually slightly closer to what has been realised in most of the experiments. Okay, so why is that?
Just a quick question. I can see that, you know, on the right hand side, you know, the semiconductor comes in because, you know, you have the gates and, you know, the semiconductor, there's some kind of effect going on.
Well, I mean, the gates in some sense are a bit tangential. What you want to do is to vary something in space, and one thing you can vary is the chemical potential. So.
Yeah, I mean, from an engineering point of view, I'm looking at it almost like a transistor. So
well, sure, I guess it's somewhat like that.
So you have a way of realizing, you know, an extra gate or terminal. But on the left-hand side, that is actually simply a wire, right? And I don't see a control terminal, but you want to vary the delta R somewhat.
Yeah, it doesn't, I mean, it really doesn't matter which of these parameters you vary. What we're going to see is that there is a sort of critical condition which has to be fulfilled somewhere on this wire, and you vary different things in order to make sure that it's fulfilled here or there.
I guess my crux of the problem maybe is elementary, it's in the sense that we want spin orbital coupling.
Yeah.
Semiconductor.
Rather than, say, an ordinary metal?
Yeah, or any other things.
Good question. I would think in principle a metal rather than a semiconductor would likely do the trick. One thing is, if you're going to vary the chemical potential, you are going to want it to be, in some sense, fairly close to zero. That is, in other words, you want to be able to vary it in and out of an energy gap, in principle. So that would be much easier with a semiconductor, I guess.
Sure, yeah. Mm. So that is very different than, you know what, we want to use engineering transistor base, because here, there's the gap, that's the point, but then the excess carrier is the holes in quantum parameter, which apparently doesn't even play a role.
Well, I would think varying, that would be the result of varying the chemical potential, wouldn't it?
All right, I'll carry on maybe.
Okay.
Okay.
Fine. So, as I say, this was the proposal that was made, and now let's have a look at how that that works. And the crucial point qualitatively is that because of the combination of spin orbit coupling and an external magnetic field, ordinary S-wave superconductivity in the niobium can induce P-wave pairing in the indium arsenide. And if the parameters do indeed vary in an interesting way, you may be able to use that to get Majorana fermion solutions. So let me try to give you at least some idea of how this works. Let's first of all consider the indium arsenide without contact with the niobium, and moreover, let's neglect, people usually do, frankly, in this area, it's a bit careless, but they usually do neglect interparticle interactions, except in some very crude mean field screening sense. What we have is just a simple single particle problem. Let's just specify the geometry for a moment. For now, let's think of all parameters as being constant in space. We have a wire which is long and thin in this direction. We're going to simply neglect any possible kinetic energy transverse to the wire on the grounds that the states in question are going to be at energies sufficiently high that at the kind of temperatures we're talking about, and typically we might be talking about a few tens of millikelvin, then the excitation of these transverse levels can be neglected. So this is our wire then, in the z direction here. We have a magnetic field. Okay, I'm afraid we're going to be chopping and changing a little with respect to the notational conventions throughout this lecture, but for the moment at least let me have my magnetic field in the x direction. Now, what about the spin-orbit interaction? Well, this comes in various shapes and sizes, but very typically what you find is that if you do indeed put two metals or a semiconductor and a metal together, then close to the interface you'll generate a so-called Rashbar electric field, and that electric field will then produce a spin-orbit interaction. Now, we have to think about that for a moment. Why is that? Well, imagine an electron moving along the wire here with some velocity v. Now, by the principles of special relativity, we know that a particle moving with velocity v in an electric field, transverse electric field E, feels an effective magnetic field V cross E, right, the vector product of V and E. So it's in the third direction, which means that now it is going, you probably can't read this, it's going to produce a spin-orbit interaction which is the X component of the spin times the Z component of momentum times the Rashbar field. So the important point is that this, we're going to drop the suffix on z because we're only talking about motion in the z direction now. So the important point is that it's going to be the Rashbar, effective magnetic field, if you like, is going to be in the x direction, but the magnitude is going to be proportional to p. That's going to be absolutely critical in what happens. So this is not a standard magnetic field. It has this rather funny form. Yeah.
Where does the relativistic effect come into place here?
Well, we believe that special relativity is a general theorem, even in solid-state physics. So,
yeah,
so
but in that equation?
Well, because... I should, strictly speaking, have written a velocity here and multiplied it by a mass, but I've simply chosen the parameter alpha so that I express it in terms of the momentum rather than velocity.
Oh, okay. Okay, so that's the relativistic
effect. Yeah, that's right, yes.
And what generate that Rashbar electric field?
Which direction? Well, normally in this kind of geometry, it'll be perpendicular to the interface here. The electric field is in the y direction. Okay, the electron is moving in the z direction, so the effective magnetic field is in the third direction. But
yeah.
As I say, it does have, crucially, it has this factor of p in it.
Yeah, but what is the mechanism of that Rashbar electric field?
Oh, okay. Good question. It's basically, a sort of work function effect. That, you know, the fact that you have different physical conditions in the niobium and in the semiconductor.
So the work function potential difference between...
Yeah, I guess essentially that. To be honest, I've never been into the detailed calculations of that, but I think that's the way it works. Anyway, the important point is that people are fairly confident that in this particular arrangement of indium arsenide with, niobium, you do get a substantial Rashbar electric field. I mean, there are experimental evidence for that. Okay, so now our single particle Hamiltonian then has these three terms. There's just the kinetic energy, which in spin space is simply proportional to the identity. There's the ordinary Zeeman field with a field along the z-axis, at least for the moment, And then we have the Rashba field, which has this funny form. It's a sort of field along the x-axis, but with this coefficient proportional to p. And as we'll see, an ordinary magnetic field would not do the trick. Okay, so here's our Hamiltonian. So for a given p, the magnitude of the effective field is, now you remember you have the ordinary Zeeman field along the z-axis, you have the Rashba field, which for given p is equivalent to a fixed magnetic field along the x-axis. So the total magnitude of the effective field by Pythagoras is just that. So that means that the energy eigenstates consist of the kinetic energy term minus mu plus or minus this field here. Now, that's not the important point. The important point is the orientation of the eigenstates. They're oriented in the xz plane at this angle here to the spin z axis. In other words, this is the picture here, where theta is simply this tangent minus 1 here. Okay, so the crucial point now is that the orientation in spin space of the state corresponding to plus p is different from that of the state corresponding to minus p. So for plus p, this is your positive state, this is your negative state. For minus p, this is your positive, this is your negative. You can write these out, these spinner wave functions. It's a standard exercise to write these out explicitly. The important point is this sine p, which occurs in here. So as you can see from this picture, what that means is that sine minus of p is not parallel to sine minus of minus p. Now let's suppose for the moment that that this condition is satisfied. E plus is greater than zero for all p. And the condition for that is either that mu, the chemical potential, is negative, or that the magnetic field is non-zero. Let's assume that's so. Then these plus states here, which are the ones which have higher energy, are never actually occupied. So now we have just a single band. However, within that single band, the spin orientation depends on p, and in particular is different for plus p and minus p. Okay, so far, let me just stop for a moment. Okay.
Crucial point is that they are not parallel, right?
Sorry?
The crucial point is the E minus and the E plus are not, they are not parallel.
Exactly. Okay, so exactly so. That's right. That's right. So what that means then is that if I look at these, stare at this particular pair of states, P and minus P, the electrons in those, assuming that only this band is occupied, the electrons in that state are not in a pure triplet state. They have at least partially a singlet amplitude. In fact, the singlet amplitude is given by this expression here. And you'll notice, crucially, this is only non-zero if you have non-zero spin orbit coupling. Otherwise, alpha is zero, and then sine theta is just zero. Okay. So the fact that this pair is not pure singlet suggests that if I now switch on an ordinary superconducting pairing amplitude or gap, I should be able to produce some of these pairs. Okay. In other words, crudely speaking, I should be able to transfer the singlet pairing in the bulk superconductor, the niobium, into at least partially spin triplet pairing in the indium arsenide. Incidentally, that's similar to something which has been known for many, many years. Long ago, very soon after the initial BCS work, people started to wonder what would be the effect of spin orbit scattering by impurities. Now, this is not Rashba, it's not by Rashba effects, it's by spin orbit scattering by bulk impurities in a three-dimensional, ordinary three-dimensional BCS superconductor. They worried what would be the effect of that. And in some sense, something similar happens there. It turns out that, well, very crudely speaking, you can think of what happens as follows. The pairing interaction is very short range, remember. Typically, in an ordinary superconductor, to be of the order of an atomic spacing or less. So it's really very short range. This means that the only for two electrons to feel the effect of the pairing, they have to be in a relative S state. Any other state has zero amplitude at close short distances. So they have to be in an S state and therefore in a spin singlet state. So indeed, in some sense, you can say the Cooper pairs form in a spin singlet state. But then, of course, they migrate. They migrate to distances large compared to the range of the potential. Remember that although the range of the potential in a typical BCS superconductor is only of the order of one or two angstroms, the interatomic spacing or less, the actual size of the pair is very much larger. It's typically of the order of a micron or something close to that. So the two components of this pair in some sense migrate to large distances. Now, in the course of migrating this way, they may easily encounter some heavy impurity, and that may then have a strong spin-orbit interaction and flip the spin. So they formed like this, as it were, then this guy gets flipped, and they end up effectively in a spin triplet state. And this is believed, or at least was believed for a long time, I think it probably still is, believed to be the reason why the spin susceptibility of some superconductors containing heavy impurities does not go to zero temperature. Crudely speaking, a superconductor has zero spin susceptibility if you have pairs formed in a singlet state, but may have a finite one if they're formed in a triplet. This is generally believed to be an explanation of that.
But in this case, you know, because of this, again, you know, the crucial point, you know, the pair are not parallel, you know, the band, you know, is not filled. So does that mean that there is scattering there? Is that where the spin or orbit coupling comes in?
Well, what we defined on the last slide, is the eigenstates of the single particle Hamiltonian here. So, sure, I mean, you can think of this, if you like, as having some kind of original term here and then some scattering term, but in some sense, I think it makes more sense to look at it as just like this from the start.
And so, you know, visually, physically, I can see the math,
but where does that spin orbit coupling come in? What is the orbit? The orbital motion is the velocity along the wire.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So that's the orbital.
That's right. Yes. Okay. Yes. But as I say, the crucial point is that although you can define, as it were, an effective magnetic field, due to the spin-orbit coupling, it will be a function of P, and in particular will change sign when you go from plus P to minus P. Okay, so now comes the interesting bit. Now switch on a phenomenological pairing term due to the proximity to the niobium. Now, how do we know that's right? Well, I mean, there's lots and lots of, there's a long history of this, lots of evidence that if I put a standard superconductor, like, say, niobium or aluminum, next to a normal metal, or for that matter, a normal semiconductor, I will induce an effective pairing interaction in the normal metal. That's a so-called proximity effect. It's a very well-known effect. It's been studied a lot. So we don't know necessarily all the details of this, but we can assume that the effective pair Hamiltonian, in the usual BCS particle non-conserving language, is some delta times here. This is a dagger. Now, careful here. I don't know if you can see this. This is a dagger up P. 8 eigen, actually I think this should be 8 eigen down minus P plus emission conjugate. In other words, this is a standard S-wave pairing gap. It couples a particle of momentum P and spin up to a particle of momentum minus P and spin down. Okay. So far there's nothing fancy about it. And this gap, incidentally, I've got a delta in here, does it play the role effectively of an energy gap in the iron arsenide? That is, would you expect to see a gap in the single fermion excitation spectrum with this magnitude? And the answer is yes. Well, that's not immediately obvious. In fact, it's a rather subtle point. But yes, the answer is you would, and indeed you do, as we shall see that in the experiments. So now what we're going to do is to rewrite this expression here in terms of the creation operators for the actual single particle energy eigenstates, which, remember, do not correspond to a single direction of spin. They correspond rather to the plus and minus. So the spin direction is varying. Okay, so when you do this, you find, not unnaturally, this guy has a component from the minus band and from the plus band, and similarly this guy here. But now these terms here, they create these plus states, and at least in the normal state, these were not occupied. Now it's not obvious they won't be occupied when you switch on this interaction, and that's what makes life a little complicated here. But for the moment, let's just discard those. This will typically be the case if the it'll be okay to discard these if the typical magnitude of the pairing energy here, delta, is much less than the excitation, the minimum excitation energy for the plus band. Okay, so this is one limit which is physical, and we can contain that. So now we get that expression, this expression here, plus its emission conjugate. And expressed in terms of that angle theta, this gives us this. And so at the end of the day, you see, what we get is an effective triplet pairing interaction here with a pairing amplitude, which is delta times sine theta p. I think there's a typo here. This, I think, forget about this. This should just be delta alpha p divided by this. Sorry, I didn't catch that. So what we have is effectively P-wave pairing in the indium arsenide. However, remember one thing, the spin states of P and minus P are actually different, and that can be important in certain applications. So a few notes on that. First of all, delta of P is, as it should be, odd in P. So this, of course, has to be the case for parallel spins. Delta P goes to zero as P goes to zero, provided that the magnetic field is finite. When B tends to, as B tends to zero, this you can basically forget about it in this expression, except for fixing the sign, and you find that delta of P is simply delta zero times the sine of P. Now you can just go ahead and grind out your the excitation energy of your fermions, and what you find is this expression here. However, this, you have to be careful, because this effective energy here is not just the usual p squared minus mu, but it's also got this additional term in it here. Now if you stare at that expression, you realize that the minimum energy gap is always at p at momentum zero, and in this limit, where delta is much less than b, is simply mu plus the magnitude of b. And therefore, we would expect the gap to close at the particular point where b is equal to mu. And now the important point is that if we have a... Remember this sort of general principle, which is... This has come up all over the place by now in topological insulators, topological superconductors, you name it. You have a system which has fermionic excitations, and the fermionic excitation energy is a function of some parameters, right, which may vary in space. And if they vary in space in such a way that the particular boundary at which the excitation energy of this fermion goes through zero, then the odds are very strong that you're going to find a Majorana fermion or something the equivalent in a topological insulator sitting there. In other words, you're going to find this funny localized state which doesn't really in some sense look like a proper electronic state at all sitting there at the boundary. And say, by now, this has occurred in so many different contexts that the people who work in the field just take it completely for granted. This is going to happen. But we can verify. We're going to verify that it will happen. Yeah. Now, unfortunately, now it gets slightly complicated. when delta is of the order of B, which will turn out to be an interesting case, then it turns out we must take into account possible excitation of the plus band, that's the one we neglected so far, by the pairing term. So even though in the normal state there were no electrons in the plus band, they may be induced in it by the superconducting pairing. Then now it turns out, I mean life is a little complicated however you do it, but it's probably easiest to go back to the original basis of up and minus, up and down. Then here is your original Hamiltonian, and now I think I've I've actually rotated my axes so that now my my Rushba field, my Rushba effective magnetic field is now along the y-axis. Sorry, I should have kept that more carefully, but we're going to use that later. Well, as we'll see, there is, in some sense, I've used a bit of a notational cheat here because this looks as if it's a two-dimensional matrix because of the matrix nature of sigma y and sigma z is actually four-dimensional. We'll come back to that. Now, if you stare at that expression here, then as p equals zero, that will become minus b, so at p equals zero, the Rushba term goes away. We're just left with the magnetic field and the gap, etc. Get this? This has a typo here. I guess this should be plus mu, plus b. Yep, sorry about that. It turns out that this matrix has eigenvalues b plus or minus root mu squared plus delta squared. So that means that I can get zero energy at p equals zero at the point where b, if there is one, where b is equal to root mu squared plus delta squared. And it turns out, again, this is no surprise to the people who've been working in this area for years. It comes out all over the place in many examples. It turns out that on one side of this point where, so we have, crudely speaking, got this wire along here, and you could be varying any of these parameters. It may be easiest if we think of varying B, although that's not going to be convenient later. So imagine that we're varying B as a function of R along here. It's going to be this point at which B is of Z is equal to root mu squared plus delta squared. We'll assume for the moment that this bit is constant in space. And then to the left of this, or rather on the side where B is higher than, so let's replot this. Let's plot B of Z minus root mu squared plus delta squared, minus its critical value here. It's going something like this. On the side where B is, sorry, I don't want to see this for a minute, this gets too horrific. On the side where B is larger than the critical value, it turns out that the state is qualitatively similar to a pure P plus IP like state. It's, in some sense, it's dominantly triplet paired and therefore dominantly P wave paired. That means that it is in some crude sense topologically non-trivial. On the other hand, when B is less than the critical value on this side here, the pairing is predominantly S wave-like, and the state is now topologically trivial. So this will be a P-like on this side and S-like on this side. And you can see that it's that it is basically just a simple BCS-like state by simply putting B equals zero, which is a special case, and simply rotating the spin axis. And you see rather easily that that's true. So in other words, in that case, you simply have a BCS pairing with a single particle energy spectrum looking like that. And then you can, in fact, if you need to, you can just reduce that to the original BCS problem by Galilean transformation to a different frame of reference. So although it does look a bit different from the original BCS state. In particular, generally speaking, it'll have a non-zero center of mass momentum, but otherwise it's pretty much BCS-like. Okay, important point, though, is that if any of the parameters vary in space, such that this condition, the condition of equality, B equals root del squared plus mu squared, it occurs at some point, say, let's choose that to be Z equals zero, then on quite general grounds, you do expect Majorana-type solutions to occur there. Okay, let me just stop at this point. Are things clear so far? Because it gets a little hairy for a couple of slides after this.
So where does condition start?
Sorry?
You say last paragraph, the condition start, where do you mean start?
I'm sorry, where are we? Here? Oh, yeah, well, that's probably on the last... well, it isn't. Sorry, it should be here, I think. This should be the asterisk equation. Sorry, yep. Okay, well, as I say, at this point it gets a little hairy because you actually do now have to take into account the full 4x4 matrix nature of the Bogoliubov-Degen equation. In other words, you've got to handle all the spin, not only the particle hole degree of freedom, but also the spin degree of freedom properly. So this is a fairly non-trivial calculation. You can't read this properly. But you see that we have this rather nasty, at first sight at least, rather nasty looking matrix equation for the solutions of the Bogoliubov-Degen equations. It turns out actually we can make it look not quite so nasty. If we introduce a compact notation, we haven't actually done this quite explicitly up to now, although it's a very standard trick in the literature, and if you are familiar with the literature, we'll recognise it. Just go back to the spin singlet case for a moment, the ordinary BCS case. You remember that when we write down the Bogoliubov-Degen equations, there's some kind of matrix equation for U and for some parameters U of R and V of R. Yeah. Crudely speaking, this is the particle component. This is the amplitude of the particle component of your Bogoliubov quasi-particle, and this is the amplitude of the Hall component. Now, it is convenient for many purposes to regard this as formally like a spin-half problem, with U and V corresponding to spin-up and spin-down. But remember, this is not real space. This is sometimes called Nambu space, because it was Nambu who first found this trick. And so we can now formally introduce spin operators in this Nambu space, and we'll call them tor x, tor y, and tor z. So for example, tor x in this space will just be 0, 1, 1, 0, etc., etc. I mean, I guess if you're a quantum information person, you might prefer this just call these x or something. But the notation in the condensed matter literature is usually tor x. Okay, so in fact, when we introduce this, this rather horrible matrix, it looks a lot simpler if we actually express it formally in terms of the components of tor. And now it looks just has this rather simpler looking form like this.
Well, as I say, it's
the basis one normally chooses, corresponding as it were to tor z, is of the particle and hole degrees of freedom. That is the upspin, up pseudospin, corresponds to the particle degree part of your Bogoliubov quasar particle, and the and spin down towards E equals minus one corresponds to the hole component. We will have to, this is a crucial point, and we're going to have to come back to this in a subsequent lecture, actually. This, in some sense, only makes sense within the mean field point of view. And in real life, things get a little more complicated than that. Formally, is a rather nice expression has a rather nice property. Generally speaking, diagonalizing a 4x4 matrix is a pain. However, life will simplify actually in two different ways, but here's one way in which it simplifies. If you stare at this expression, you see that most of the terms in it anti-commute. This one, unfortunately, if this guy were absent, all the terms in this expression would anti-commute. This means that when you square it, you get something which does not look too horrible. In fact, it can actually be reduced to a 2x2 matrix, and then you can diagonalize it. So one can actually write down expressions for the energy eigenvalues. I won't do it because they're not terribly useful at the present stage, but in some of the papers it is done. A slightly, perhaps a more important point, the operator sigma y tau y anti-commutes with all the terms on the left-hand side of this expression. That looks like a formal statement. It's actually a generalization of the simple symmetry of the S-wave BDG equations. Remember that in the simple S-wave, if you replace U and V by minus V star and U star, then you get a solution of, you start off with a Bogoliubov-Degen solution with energy E, and you find that this has energy minus E. This is this famous particle hole symmetry here. And so the generalization is that if psi is a solution with energy plus E, then this operator acting on psi is a solution with energy minus E. And in particular, if E is zero, then you can choose sigma y tau y of psi to be plus or minus psi. In other words, what that means is that V up and down is minus lambda times U, with lambda equals plus or minus one. So what that's, okay, this looks a bit formal. What it's actually saying is that the spin structure of the hole component is identical to that of the particle component. And that's crucial for having a Majorana, because if that were not the case, then the particle would not be its own antiparticle. So that is nice. And then the 4x4 BDG equations reduced to 2x2. And if you compare these with what's in the literature, they may not look exactly the same. That's only a consequence of my choice of spin axes. But now what's interesting is that this, we're now talking, these two components here are now not U and V, but U up and U down. In other words, we're talking about real spin space, not Nambu space here. Now still, alas, even with this simplification, the analysis is quite complicated, and you have to look it up in detail in these two papers. However, in certain limits we can get some progress. Let's consider the limit of strong spin orbit coupling, meaning this condition here, with only the gap varying in space. Then you get this rather simpler equation here, and if you define delta of z as b squared minus mu squared, so that we fix the origin so that delta zero of typo here. This should be delta zero of zero. That is, at point zero, is b squared minus mu squared. In other words, we define our origin as the point at which this critical condition occurs. Right? And then expand, and Taylor expand z around the origin. then what we find is this expression, this equation here. And this is beginning to look as if it might even be a bit manageable. So without the term in lambda, the solution would just be a standard area function which falls off. Now you remember that the area function is complicated in general, but at large distances it falls off as exponential minus x to the 3/2, minus mod x to the 3/2, so it'd be like so. And it turns out that at least under certain conditions the terms in lambda don't affect that very much. You can, before I discuss the details of that, which gets a bit messy, let's just go into a rather simpler example. This is a very artificial example, but let's just assume that if we plot out delta of z, rather than, it's delta now, we're allowing to vary in space, and we're holding the other things constant. If we do that, then we find a smooth curve for delta, and it will cross at a particular position here. Let's make a very artificial model in which delta is roughly constant here, and in other words, it goes through zero. So it has that form here. Then actually you get an explicit solution. You simply find that on either side of the origin, the solution is exponentially decaying. Again, that's the form of your gap. What does the form of your solution for the wave function look like? It looks like that, roughly. Okay. Notice that that is continuous at z equals zero. It has a discontinuous derivative. However, you don't have to worry about that because your original equations, which give rise to this result, were first order and not second order. So it's enough that the function itself is continuous. Okay, this is a sort of rather general characteristic of these Majorana-like solutions. Technical point here, if you go through the literature, you'll see this lambda equals plus or minus 1 introduced. Those don't actually correspond to physically different solutions because of this symmetry here. So at the end of the day, at least and you can actually see it quite explicitly in this very trivial artificial model, you see quite explicitly there's one and only one Majorana fermion at the separatrix point, that is this point here. Let me just go back for a moment to the slightly more complicated case. You can argue that similar conclusions are correct for a more natural example in which the gap is smoothly varying. And if you, this is all worked out in detail in the papers which I referred to. Okay, so that's this paragraph here. So we can forget about that now. But this is important, though. One thing I do want to draw your attention to is that all components of the Hamiltonian were necessary in order to generate these Majorana fermions. First of all, what happens if we eliminate any one of them? Well, if delta equals zero, well, then obviously you may get some kind of zero energy bound state occurring near the point, say, at which mu goes through zero. It won't be a Majorana in the usual sense. In order to get particle hole mixing, which is very characteristic of a Majorana, you have to have a non-zero gap. What about alpha equals zero? That is no spin orbit coupling. Well, then get an S wave gap in the niobium. But now with no spin orbit coupling, all you have in your indium arsenide, all you can ever generate in your indium arsenide, is a simple S-wave superconductor, right? So, which will not be adequate to give rise to the Majoranas. The nicer point is, what happens if B is equal to zero? Alternatively, this is very important, what happens if B is parallel to the Rashba field, the effective magnetic field due to the Rashbow effect. In that case, the spin direction of the pairing is unique independently, so it should be independently of P. Although the magnitude of the field will depend on P, the direction will be the same for all P. So that means that you always have a pure triplet state. The state which you would like to form in the, or you're trying to form in the indium arsenide would be pure triplet, and therefore this cannot be induced by the S-wave gap. So all of these components are necessary, and notice this one in particular, because as I say, this wave will play a rather important role. So B has to be non-zero, it has to be perpendicular, or at least partially perpendicular, to the Rashbow field. Okay, so far? Well, some of this is, as I say, rather technical. To assure yourself these slightly hand-waving arguments are right, you do have to go back to the original papers, where they do it in minute detail, but it does come out. Okay, so we've had our artificial example. Bottom line, if you have a separatrix at which this condition is satisfied, one and only one Majorana fermion setting should sit there. Incidentally, how do you know that you're going to get another Majorana fermion sitting somewhere else? Well, basically, because at the end of the day, imagine that you, as it were, connected up your... We're going to be talking, in fact, about wires. So imagine that I've got my wire sitting along here, and here's my point Z equals zero, and at that point, for example, I don't know, the gap is coming through zero here. Right? How do I know that at the end of the day, I've got to have another point at which a Majorana is going to occur? Because remember that by their nature, Majoranas only occur in pairs. So if I've got one there, there has to be one sitting somewhere else. Well, let's imagine, for the moment, artificially, I just join this up in a sort of ring geometry. Then it's clear that if delta, assume for the moment that delta is going to be real, if it crosses zero here, it's got to cross a zero somewhere else to get back to single valuedness. Okay. Now, you could ask, okay, what happens if delta is complex? And that's a slightly more complicated matter, but we don't usually have to worry about that in the prism context because, generally speaking, we can choose the phase of delta to be constant in space. If the phase of delta were not constant in space, that would, crudely speaking, imply there's a current actually flowing through the niobium. That's an interesting case, but it's not the one that is realized in experiments. So yeah, we always do find there is a second point. And typically in the experiments it's arranged so that both those points do occur somewhere in the experimentally interesting region. Okay. So just suppose, for the sake of argument, that you have actually produced this situation where you get at least one and hopefully two Majoranas occurring in the experimentally interesting region. How might we now go about finding them? That is, how might we identify that we've actually got a pair of Majoranas and not something more familiar? And this has been a huge area of debate over the last 5 years or so. I will just try to give you a very rough picture of some of the main conclusions here. The first characteristic which people tend to seize on here is a zero bias anomaly in the differential tunneling conductance, which, as measured, say, by putting a STM, a scanning tunneling microscope, tip down on the metal and examining the current voltage characteristics. So suppose that you do have a bound state existing at a particular point in the wire, exactly at energy zero. Now, remember that energy zero is a slightly ambiguous concept. What that actually means is that, as it were, relative to true vacuum, the energy is, the, is exactly the chemical potential. At this point, then if you plot out dIdV up the vertical axis, well, let me just stop for a moment. I'll go back for a moment. Suppose I had a standard BCS superconductor and I do some kind of tunneling experiment into it, for example, in the way that Gaver originally did, and I measure the voltage along this axis, and along this axis I measure the conductance, not the current itself, but the conductance. What do I expect to find? And what did Gaver find in his original experiments? What he found was that, forget this for a moment, what he found was that when V is less than E, than delta, the bulk energy gap divided by E, the electron charge, then you've got essentially no tunneling conductance. And that's basically because there are no states to tunnel into. The moment you get to a value of V larger than E delta, you actually get a substantial tunneling conductance, which is actually rather larger than it would have been in the normal state. So in fact, this is slightly scaled down. It's more like this in real life. And so that's what you'd find in a standard Gaver tunneling setup. No fancy majorana or anything around. Okay, now what do you expect if you've got a zero energy state, so-called zero bias state? Well, when you're very close to zero voltage, you would expect to be able to tunnel into that state and you'd get a sharp increase in the conductance. Now, of course, you have to. One of the things that people tend to forget, especially the theorists who think about this sort of thing, is that it's no use, as it were, tunneling into your Majorana state unless there's somewhere to go from there. You've got to be able to carry on, as it were, tunnel further into the perhaps the distant Majorana, something of the kind. So, for example, if you were to look at formally at the problem of tunneling into a Kitaev quantum wire, then in fact there certainly is a one single fermion state with zero energy relative to the ground state, and in principle, presumably, you could tunnel into it. But that doesn't communicate with anything else. What you would need then at that point is the overlap of the two Majorana states. If you do have that overlap, you expect a zero bias anomaly. That's been, incidentally, yes, on this subject, this general subject of the tunneling characteristics of Majorana states, a number of good papers, but these three I think are particularly useful. This one is rather formal. These two are easier to read, though, as I'll discuss in a moment, this one is not actually quite about the experiment problem as it's realised in experiment. This one is probably closest to Ori et al., closest to what is actually realised in the real experiments. Okay. Now, I say the theory predicts a conductance of a half. ZBA, zero bias anomaly. So it's an anomaly which occurs at, it's an anomaly in the tunneling, in the conductance, which occurs at zero voltage bias. That's the only reason for the name. Okay, conductance quantization. Well, I say theory predicts that the conductance is half of that of the ordinary single fermion state. That's a slightly ambiguous statement, actually. The paper which is usually referred to in this context is this one of Law et al. However, if you actually look at their paper, it is not discussing the kind of experimental setup that I've been analysing. Let me just take a moment to say a word about it, because I think what they are discussing is rather interesting. What they are actually discussing is the following arrangement. You have an S-wave superconducting state here, and you have a single vortex sitting in it, and then you attach leads in such a way that you expect a You expect a pair of my. Oh, no. Okay. Careful does it. I'm sorry. I misspoke. I said this should be a P plus IP superconductor, and it may or may not have a single vortex in it. Okay. If it does not have, and these leads are just, I guess they're simple normal metal leads here. And now, and so you assume that you are making contact at, or you may make contact either at both these points or just one of them, or neither. Okay. This is a rather interesting setup, because where do you expect your Majoranas to occur in this one? Well, we know that in a vortex, or a P plus IP superconductor, you're going to get a Majorana occurring at the vortex here. But that's only one. Where does the other one occur? That's an interesting question. It actually turns out that it occurs around the rim here. So although we usually think of So if we, and we normally think of Majoranas as strictly localized in space, that it really isn't quite true here. The Majorana is certainly localized in the radial direction, but it's not localized in the circumferential direction. In fact, it can actually have, and this is worked out in detail in the literature, it can actually have a finite momentum around the circumference there. And so what Law and Company are actually looking at in their paper is this situation here, and they're asking how does the transmitted current depend? Well, first of all, I think it's fairly obvious that in order for the total current through the device to be non-zero, you have to have a finite coupling T1 here and a finite coupling T2 here. If either of those were zero, then fairly clearly you can't transmit current through this device. That seems sort of common sense in a way. Now the interesting question is what you expect for the zero bias conductance in this and in this geometry, and what Lee, Law and Company find is that if you've got no vortex here, so and therefore no Majorana out here, you get nothing at zero bias. Essentially, just no fermion states to tunnel through. If, on the other hand, you have a single vortex sitting there, and therefore a second Majorana sitting on the circumference, then you get a conductance, actually 2e squared over h bar, h, sorry, this is sort of a standard Landauer unit of conductance. Get this zero bias conductance. It's a little difficult to trace in their calculation where the factor 2 comes from, but I think it comes from the fact that the Majorana in this situation actually, in the situation they physically consider, has two spin states associated with it. Anyway, the usual way of putting this result is that this zero bias conductance would be a half of that of an ordinary single fermion state. This is a little tricky because this geometry is not something which people usually consider. But this is a sort of very hand-waving, naive argument for this. In a constricted geometry, is a very familiar classical result due to originally Landauer, that the total conductance is the number of channels available times e squared over h. It's the famous Landauer formula. Now, an ordinary, if we consider the transmission due to an ordinary Bogoliubov quasar particle, then, well, in the standard way of thinking, it has a particle, it can be a particle or a hole. Have E or minus E. As I say, I think this way of thinking about it is a bit dodgy, but it's the standard way. And that comes to two channels. On the other hand, the Majorana fermion is both particle and hole in one, so that's only one channel, and therefore you expect the conductance to be reduced by a factor of two. That is not a terribly strong or convincing argument to my mind, but it's the sort of argument you tend to find. At least had, what do you mean? A third characteristic, which again, for which again people often refer to this paper of Law et al., although, as I say, it's really talking about a different geometry from what we're talking about when we discuss the real experiments. It is the so-called four pi Josephson effect. What does that mean? To derive this in the context of Majorana fermions, people usually go through a so-called Andreyev bound state calculation. That is, they work out the fermionic spectrum of the actual junction, the piece of metal or semiconductor which is joining your two superconductors, and then they claim that since this Majorana fermion-related Andreyev bound state contributes to the ground state energy, it should depend, that the ground state energy should depend on the cosine of the phase of this Majorana fermion. However, okay, this is where it gets, again, slightly dodgy. I should say right away, I don't find a lot of the arguments which are in the literature at this point particularly convincing, and the reason is that I believe the whole approach may be based on a bad foundation. But as I say, I'm just trying to reproduce what is in the literature. As the phase of the condensate rotates through 2 pi, the phase of the Majorana fermion allegedly should rotate through pi. Remember, that was Ivanov's result. And since I is proportional to dE by d phi, that should mean that I is proportional to the sine of the phase of the Majorana fermion wave function, and that is half of the phase of the condensate wave function. And so, the current due to the Majorana fermion state allegedly has a periodicity in the condensate phase, which is 4 pi and not 2 pi. And people make a big deal of this. I don't think, in fact, that they should, for the following reason. The very old argument due to Bloch way back in 1970, which goes as follows. Let's consider a rather generic situation in which we have a squid ring, a superconducting ring, with a flux capital phi through it, and we have some kind of Josephson junction. It could, for example, be a nanowire, as a perfectly good possible Josephson junction, or it could be just a tunnel oxide junction. It doesn't really matter. Yeah. define the standard superconducting flux quantum as h over 2e. Notice the factor of 2. Remember, if you were talking about something like the quantum Hall effect, then you tend to define the flux quantum as h over e. But for superconductors, because you're dealing with Cooper pairs, you'd normally define it as h over 2e. That's a standard definition. And now it turns out that because of gauge invariance and the Meissner effect, if anyone wants me to go into that, I can do it, but it's a standard result that the phase drop across the junction is just the total flux through the loop in units of the superconducting flux quantum. Okay, so far so good. Now, there's a very famous theorem due to Byers and Yang. Suppose I apply my flux here under so-called Aharonov-Bohm conditions. That is, I arrange things so that there is no external flux, no external field anywhere on the ring itself. Okay. The flux is entirely trapped through the junction. Under those conditions, the energy of the system, according to the Byers-Yang theorem, is periodic in h over e. Notice not h over 2e, but h over e. Yeah. That means that, most generally, the energy associated with the phase drop across the junction, that is, crudely speaking, the energy of the junction, is periodic in phi over 2, not phi. In other words, you get this expansion here. When you now differentiate that to get the current, again, the current is just the derivative of E with respect to phi. So again, it has all these terms in it. Now, in the standard theory of Joseph's injunctions, as you read it in textbooks, you normally neglect the odd n terms, in particular the term corresponding to n equals 1 here. Why? Well, if you go, so you can ask yourself the following question. Suppose I don't even, for example, have superconductivity, because after all, the Bayes-Yang theorem has nothing intrinsically to do with superconductivity, it's much more general. Imagine that I just had some kind of normal ring here, and I had the possibility of transport across the junction. The Bayes-Yang theorem applies. I would expect the flux in general to be periodic in phi over 2 and not in phi. In other words, it would be so-called 4 pi periodic. However, I usually neglect the terms with odd n. What does that physically correspond to? Well, the terms in, let's say, to take the n equals 1 term. Physically, that ought to correspond to the tunnelling of single electrons, not Cooper pairs, across my junction. And so why should I neglect this? In fact, in certain other contexts, I say mesoscopic, small mesoscopic rings, I might not want to. However, the argument, crudely speaking, I mean, this is rarely actually stated in any of the papers or textbooks, but crudely speaking, the argument is that in the case of the of single particle tunnelling, you have lots and lots and lots of different states, so that you would get, sure, you would get contributions to this, but they'd all be sort of randomly phased with respect to one another. And therefore you would expect, under normal conditions, this this contribution due to normal tunneling, normal electron tunneling, would essentially cancel because of the randomness of the relative phases. On the other hand, of course, with the Cooper pairs are more or less by definition in a unique state. So there's only a single phase associated with those. So that, as I say, that's the implicit argument by which people usually neglect these on-end terms. But you see now it's coming back to bite us. Because what this is saying is that if you have any kind of mechanism associated with your junction or wire or whatever, any kind of mechanism by which you can get, as it were, unique single particle tunneling without cancellation of the phases, then it's going to give you this 4 pi effect. So so the mere fact that we see in the experiments a 4 pi periodicity really doesn't tell us very much. Finally, teleportation. Well, okay, that's again a vexed subject. I think the best discussion of teleportation within the standard mean field approach is the one of Tiwari et al. In this paper here. They actually reached the conclusion that you would not get what you could genuinely call teleportation. That is, what would it look like if you were to get teleportation? Well, crudely speaking, what you would do is to apply to take a situation in which you've got a pair of Majorana's, which are, say, a mile apart, apply a voltage to one, and instantaneously, or over a time small compared to the transmission speed of the transmission time of the Fermi velocity, you'd get a response at the other end. Okay, that would be spectacular. However, according to Tiwari et al., that doesn't happen, even within the standard approach. And I'll come back later to why it may happen and not happen more generally.
Compared to the thermal velocity?
Sorry? No. Okay. In degenerate Fermi systems, which is what we're mostly talking about here, they're not entirely, the characteristic velocity is usually thought to be something like the Fermi velocity, okay, which is typically about a hundredth of the speed of light. So if you were to get a response which was at over a time interval which was small compared to L divided by that, the distance divided by that Fermi velocity, that would be really rather spectacular. And some papers in the literature have proposed that. But I think the discussion of Tiwari et al. Is fairly satisfactory on that. They find you don't get any transmission at all unless your two Majoranas overlap, which is sort of, in some sense, common sense. You think if they don't overlap, then there's no way of having, as it were, transmitted the electron into one state. There's no way of getting it out of the other. So. Let me think. I wonder if I should I shouldn't start the experiments now. So let me postpone the actual experimental situation. It won't take very long, but let me postpone that until the next lecture. I want to spend, actually, so I would like to finish this off, because it's obviously an interesting subject, and you ought to know where things stand. I want to spend most of the next lecture actually starting to talk about some doubts about the standard approach and why I think that there are a lot of unanswered questions in there. So let me stop at this point, perhaps, and go on with this in the next lecture. Any general questions, comments, objections?
So, again, you know, the role of the semiconductor, suppose the metal or whatever is the gap.
I think, as I say, one reason why I think people tend to use semiconductors rather than metals is that because it's a lot easier to control the chemical potential, and in particular to vary it through this characteristic point. Incidentally, there's one sort of general comment here. When you actually go through these arguments in detail for a P plus IP, and this is quite generally true, I mean, it's true of the original arguments about the formation of Majorana fermions in the cores of vortices and so forth. Okay. When you actually go through that in detail, you find that the fermion states involved are mostly not anywhere near the Fermi momentum. They're much closer to zero momentum. So in some sense, all the intuition that one tends to have built up in the BCS theory of superconductivity, where all the action is confined to near the Fermi surface, can be quite misleading in this context. So you really have to sort of think about it from scratch. Yeah, so I think that's probably the main reason why people tend not to use metals.
In a sense, a semiconductor, I suppose, is a practical issue that would be a doping, you can control, your Fermi level or chemical potential a lot easier.
Yeah, I think that's, as I say, that's one main reason. There may well be other reasons associated, for example, with the fact that you want to produce a substantial Rashba field. And notice, incidentally, that if you stare at all these rather complicated-looking 4x4 formulae and so forth, let's just go back to those for one moment, because there's this rather interesting point. Here. If you actually stare at this expression here, then you will actually see that there's nowhere in it that the Rashba spin orbit coupling explicitly appears. It's sort of somehow gone away from the explicit equations, and that's even more clear perhaps. I'm talking nonsense, I should take that back. That is nonsense, because here we actually see the Rashba spin orbit constant appearing. But by the time you actually get to solving this equation in detail, for example, for this, the Rashba spin orbit coupling does appear in the expression for the size of your Majoranas, but it does not appear anywhere in the condition for their occurrence. So the Majoranas will appear independently of the magnitude of the Rashba spin orbit coupling, provided it's non-zero. However, their actual spatial dimensional extent will depend on that. Okay, so as I say, so let's just postpone then the discussion of the current experimental situation until the beginning of the next lecture, and as I say, I'll try to spend most of the next lecture on the first part of my objections to the sort of standard approach, and why I think it may be misleading.